Welcome to the season 2 of the Youth of Future podcast. This is Sushrut.
This is Tanish.
And we hope to bring you immense value through our episodes. So, you know, a champion is someone who gets up even when he can't. Today we have one such person with us. Here's Parvand.
Hello everyone. My name is Parvand Krishnan and I play Taekwondo for India. I am ranked number 3 in India and number 232 in the world. And I thank you guys so much for having me today, and your podcast is going to help put out a good story into the world. So thanks, guys.
Yeah, it's our pleasure, man. It's our pleasure. You know, so like I want to ask this question. Let's get into it. So you've been in this field for a long time now, and starting is very difficult. But you know what is very, what is even more difficult is actually coming back after a setback. So let's dive straight into it. And like, do you have any a good comeback story?
I have quite the one, and it's very recent actually. So 2017 was a very good year for, you know, generally me and all the people of my academy. And, you know, we were in almost something we can call the touch of our lives, physically and technically. But then, you know, 2018 came, and the same form was, you know, carried forward. But what happened is we went for the Asian Championship trial in Ranchi. And there I had an injury to my left wrist, which, you know, at the start, it was just, you know, an impact injury and, you know, nothing serious. So I showed it to the doctor, and the doctor said, you know, just took an X-ray and said that, you know, it's just a ligament problem. So you can just wrap it up and keep playing, you know, apply ice whenever it pains or something like that. So then I continued. And what happened is in June, after playing a couple of tournaments after this injury, the pain didn't stop. So we consulted one of the better, you know, hand surgeons in Pune. And he asked me to get an MRI and some scans done. And when the report came back, you know, the first time we went to him after the reports came back, he said, "Have you read the report?" I said, "Yeah, we read, there's a fracture and things like that." So the first thing he told me was that, "Parvan, this is the end of the road for you. You can't play Taekwondo anymore." So, you know, that was how this all started off. And then, so he then gave us a full, you know, diagnosis of what all had happened. And he said, "There's the MRI shows there's a ligament tear. There's one bone that no blood is reaching the bone." So he told us some conditions and said that it'll have to be operated upon, and that there was no Taekwondo after the surgery. So it was a huge shock, you know. And then we took a second opinion because, you know, naturally we weren't ready to believe this kind of thing. And then we took a second opinion, but it was quite clear that he was right. And, you know, there was, surgery was the only option. So we went forward with it. After about 2 months, we got the surgery done. It was quite a bad experience, meaning the 5 months of physiotherapy and recovery after that, it was quite painful, you know. And the thing is, they had to do a bone grafting. So there was an incision to my left wrist, and there was an incision in my hip as well. So it was quite hard. And then after the surgery, you know, the 5 to 6 months of not training because of the incision in the hip, and then having to sit out of the class, not train, because of the hip, I couldn't do any strength exercises as well. Mm-hmm. So it was quite a disturbing period. But then 6 months later, the doctor said, "Okay, you have done pretty well in your recovery. So you'll have a full recovery. You'll get your full range of motion back." And there was one day where we just went to him for a follow-up. You know, we had been prepared for a retirement, if you can call it that.
Okay.
But then he said that, "Yeah, you'll make a full recovery." And there was one day we went to him and he said, "Fine, you can now start competing again."
Oh,
that was one of the happiest moments of my life. And then after that, the thing is, the first tournament I played after that was the University Nationals, which was in Rohtak. And immediately from there, we went to the World Championships trial in Tamil Nadu.
Okay.
And those two tournaments didn't get a great result. But after that, I went to the India Open in Hyderabad. Got some good performances there. And went to Chuncheon right after that. So I can say I came back pretty well.
Yeah.
And so that's,
yeah,
I think the biggest comeback story.
After of the first game that you played after this complete injury?
I was actually quite nervous because, you know, this whole experience that I have had with Taekwondo is that once you get injured, the chances are that you get injured in the same spot again and again. Right. Because it becomes weak, right? You don't get, sometimes you don't get enough time to strengthen it again.
Mm-hmm.
So the fear was that, you know, the same spot will get injured and what if this time it doesn't heal as well?
Mm-hmm.
So that fear was there. So there were all kinds of precautions, you know, stuffing the gloves with crepe bandage, taping the hand up. So all that was there. But, you know, certain basic changes in technique, like keeping the fist closed, keeping the hands close to the body, very basic improvements helped me to not ever get injured there again. So since then, I have never had an injury to the same place. So it's like a lesson.
Nice.
Basically, it is said that, you know, when you are hit with a problem, it actually changes your life for the better. It is the difference that makes the difference. Like, there are a lot of stories. Like, there was this person, I cannot take the name right now, but there was this person who was actually a bike rider and he was an international bike rider, but he did not achieve any gold medals until before he got testicular cancer. And, you know, it is very difficult for a man to actually, who actually drives a bike as his profession, to have testicular cancer, but still overcome. And, you know, this is an amazing story, right? Because this comeback, the difference that made the difference, the testicular cancer actually pushed him emotionally more to get to his target. And that is how he set up to achieve and set more records. Okay, so this brings us to our next question.
Yeah, he won 7 championships. Yeah.
He won 7 championships.
After this whole thing. Wow. Yeah.
All games are 80% strategy and 20% effort. So what do you have to say about strategies and effort?
Actually, I would put it the other way around. It's 80% effort and 20% strategy. Because, you know, I have been watching these international tournaments closely. And strategy is important. But then the thing is that it's not as important or as vital to a game as pushing yourself and giving 100%.
Mm-hmm.
Because there is always going to be a time when, you know, you don't see, to make strategies, you need to know what you're up against. It's the most basic requirement. But there are always going to be times when you don't know your opponent or you don't know his styles. You have never seen him play before. You have not even heard his name before.
Mm-hmm.
So in such cases, the important thing is to just stick with the basics or stick to what you are comfortable with and just try and capitalize on your strengths. And as you go ahead with the game, you keep discovering what his weaknesses and his strengths are.
And work
accordingly. Yeah. Okay. You know, also, like when you're in the field and you're prepared, but the mind often plays games and makes us doubt ourselves, even though we know we are 100% prepared. So how do you deal with the pressure and how do you tame your mind?
So pressure, one has to face it. Everyone handles it differently. So there are physical reactions to pressure. There are behavioral reactions to pressure. Like some people will sweat a lot. Some people feel sleepy. I'm one of those people. I feel very sleepy under pressure. It's just a physical thing. There's nothing I can do about it. So it's unavoidable and everybody handles it differently. But the key is to, you know, accept it, embrace it and channelize it. Because if it's something that is going to be there, then you can't try and escape it. You have to accept it and then try and see how you can make the best use of it. So, and some there are some people who actually flourish under pressure. So many examples of it in my own academy, people who in practice will perform very ordinarily or, you know, make half-hearted efforts. But when they are actually competing and under pressure, they'll give performances that, you know, even the coach sometimes feels that these are unheard levels of performance.
Okay.
And sometimes what happens is when you compete for a long time or continuously in a short period of time, pressure becomes your friend. you know how to manage it, and it is, you know, what we call butterflies in the stomach. So that feeling is actually quite important for good performance, because the people who don't feel pressure are very unlikely to perform at, you know, the peak of the performance levels.
Yeah.
Is it okay to say that the people who actually don't feel the pressure don't take the complete thing seriously?
I think, yes, it will be safe to say that. But there are some people who are naturally, you know, whose natural reaction to any kind of stress is to just, you know, just go all out and not worry about it.
Right, keep grinding.
That's there too.
Yeah. You know, also, how do you deal with self-doubt?
Actually, the thing is, these things are more to do with the long periods of practice before a competition or before any major fail. So, you know, the harder you have trained, the less likely you are to doubt yourself. So if you know that you are at a certain level, then there is a good chance that you have a perfect idea of where you stand with respect to the competition and what kind of performance levels you are likely to reach. So because what happens is, when you go for international tournaments, we can take a look at the lot sheet and we know which players perform how well and which players are unheard of or whatever. So, and plus there's a ranking system at the international level. So based on the rank, you can gauge a player a little bit. So that's one factor. And, you know, I think self-doubt is something that you can't, you know, it comes at times, but you just have to, you know, power through it.
Powering through it, very strong word. You know, basically, when you have self-doubt and stuff, you just use it to channelize and tell yourself about what you want to become. Great. So this gets us to the next question, which is, do you believe in the power of mind?
Yeah, definitely. The mind is, it's either the most potent tool you have, or it can also be the biggest obstacle in your way.
Okay.
So like you said, self-doubt, then people, you know, feel that, you know, how can I, you know, compete with the people at the top levels? So this doubt or this false notion that other people are superior for some reason, or we are inferior for some reason, can be a huge obstacle. So just the other day, when this page had put up the story about me, I received a message saying that, what is Mission 2024? So I told him, it's the Paris Olympics. So he said, can I participate too? I said, why not? So he says that, so then what do I have to do for it? I said, you have to compete in the international level tournaments and get your ranking up. So he said that, you know, those international level tournaments are too difficult and I can't win there. So things like this, that, you know, something is too difficult to do, is just, it's a huge obstacle, you know. It may well be that the person who sent me this message is, you know, a really good player, but it's just there in his mind that, you know, something is too difficult, or those people are far superior than us. So there's no reason to believe all this. I don't know why people do.
So basically, what you are saying is that your mind is like a huge machine and you control all of it. And you can either use the powers to dig a hole for yourself, or use the powers to actually get something done, get something good done for yourself.
Yeah. You can, but the part where you control it completely is also not true, because, you know, you can control a certain part of it, and that certain part that you do control, it all depends on how you manage that.
Okay.
So like things like determination, you know, willpower, these things have to come from within. And there is an amazing thing that I have experienced called personal growth. You know, the belief and the want for personal growth is such an amazing thing that it can do wonders. But, you know, the thing is, people need to discover it more. They need to explore the possibilities more. And people need to be told about it.
Yeah. Yeah. You know,
so it is through podcasts and stories like these that it's going to come forward.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah, you know, so when I when I was playing at a competitive level, I used to play chess. So what happened was my coach used to tell me to go and visualize the result and imagine how everything will work out in your favor. Not like just wishful thinking, but actually visualizing the problems and how you will overcome them. And just, I didn't get it back then, but he was telling me to actually convey the message to my subconscious mind. So do you believe in those things?
Yeah, visualization is one of the things we do. So what happens is while training, so suppose I'm running on the treadmill and I have nothing to do, you know, there's music playing and stuff like that. So I'm constantly thinking about the next tournament, the people I may face there, what their styles are, how I will tackle them, things like that. And then of course there's, you know, visualization of when you're not doing anything, you just visualize, I won the gold medal at the Olympics and things like that. It's just, you know, it's something you just keep doing no matter what level you're at.
Yeah. You know, so basically your mind does not know the difference between vivid visualization and reality. So because if you have visualized something very clearly and you have like done a lot of, you're into it completely, your mind makes it into a real experience. You know, it's the level of congruency that your mind goes to in order to get to the goal of your visualization. So there was this interesting study conducted. You can read about it. It's really good. And also, one more thing is, like, do you believe in the subconscious mind?
I do. Because the thing is, so my personal experience, I have observed that during tournaments, there are some people who before the fights, they just go into their own, you know, their own world. Like, you can say something to them, and they won't even realize it. So they kind of zone out and they are completely focused on the fight and what they're going to do rather than what is going on around them, which is, I think, a very good thing. And the second thing is that, you know, some things that you have never done during training, I have experienced this personally during a fight, that some things that I have never done during training, but, you know, certain techniques or something like that. So, which I have never done during training, but during the fight, I see the chance and it just comes out, mm-hmm. which is, you know, kind of, I think, which is a feature of, you know, somewhere at the back of the mind, I have it, but it just, it's not, I can't do it deliberately. It just comes out.
Okay.
And, you know, the visualization, like you said, so visualization is basically, you know, stimulating the subconscious mind. So you're mm-hmm. trying to get your mind into a phase where if that occasion actually arrives, you're not overwhelmed by the occasion.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. You have a kind of, even though it's fake, you have an idea of how it's going to be and what you're expected to do.
Yes.
Okay, so basically when you start or aren't doing well, you face criticism and you are often interrupted by setbacks. How can one deal with those?
See, setbacks are going to be there whether it's sport or any other field. And the thing is, people, I don't know if it's, you know, a feature of what it is a feature of, but, you know, people are very quick to inject negativity into somebody who is doing something different. So people are afraid of the different. I don't know why. So they think that if somebody is doing something different, it's going to end up badly. And they, you know, they just feel free to be vocal about it. So I feel that the key to criticism is that you should break it down to a logical level.
Okay.
So you listen to something that somebody says, which is critical of what you're doing. You listen to it. You analyze it. And if there's something that you can really take from it, then definitely work on it. Because, you know, not all criticism is negative. There is constructive criticism. So you, if there's something to take from it, definitely take it. And then if the, you just leave out the rest, because you say yes to everybody and then just do what you want to do.
Mm-hmm.
That's what I follow.
So basically you have to be kind of not, I won't say selfish, but kind of selfish to actually, you know, get only the advice that helps you.
Yeah, you have to basically be able to just take certain part and leave out the rest and not be bothered by it. You know, some people go into this thing, how can he say like this? How can he say like that? But I think just leave that part out. Listen to everybody, say yes to everybody, and just then do whatever you feel is right. And also the people around somebody who's doing something different. I think if they can't say something that helps, they shouldn't say anything at all. If you feel something is wrong, constructive criticism is more than welcome. But just plain and simple negativity, that is the problem.
Right.
So if you can't say something that can help, don't say anything at all.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense. Yeah. You know, also, like, you play at such a high level, so you must have encountered failures. How do you deal with those?
So failures, yes, quite a lot of them. But the thing is,
like, you have a story.
You know, you can't start winning immediately. So the first thing is to be prepared for failure. And, you know, accept the fact that there are going to be failures. You can't say that I'll start playing now and within a few months I should get results. You will not. Because there are guys who have worked for years and years who are much older than you, much more experienced than you, and most times have worked harder than you. So then it's very difficult to put in words the feeling of losing. But what we try to do is we, you know, analyze the graph of performance rather than a win or a loss. You analyze whether your performance graph has been going up or it has stabilized or it is going down. So you look at it as a graph and we try to be more concerned with whether the graph is going up or not. So if it's going up and I lose a fight, it's fine. And if I'm winning fights, but my graph is stabilized or it's going down, then it's a reason to worry. And I have to work on it in training. So that's the approach we follow.
Yeah. Also, do you have a failure story? Like majority, like what happens is me and Tanish, before this whole thing was up, we actually failed in 2 startups. And like, they didn't even get off the ground, like no response, nothing. And like, those 2 startups are now the foundation of what we do here. Like, they are the current foundation of what, like, it'll be out soon, the whole announcement is soon, but this is the first time I'm talking about it. Like, the whole thing, which we had 2 ideas, which were really unique and no one was doing it. And we tried to base our whole thing on those 2 ideas. And what happened was we got 0 response. Like, it was out, it was aired, everything, we spent some money on it, we got 0 response. But the 2 lessons that we learned, they were priceless. So whenever we with so much love, with much fondness, because without that, this wouldn't have happened. So we believe that failure is a stepping stone for success, or at least progress, and progress equals happiness. So what do you have a failure story?
There are many. So I'll tell you about the most recent one. So I went to UAE and there was a tournament there, and from there we had to go to Jordan. So UAE was an okay performance, fine, everything done. Jordan, it was just the 2 of us. So me and my teammate, and we went there, and you know, it was quite a good lot for me. So just 3 fights, 3rd fight final. And if I won the first fight, I would have won the bronze medal by default. So it was a direct quarterfinal. And the guy I faced in the quarterfinal was from Luxembourg. And he was world rank 899 with about 1 or 2 points. And I thought, okay, fine. This is a very good draw. So bronze medal in the pocket. And let's take it from there. So first fight, you know, I go up all ready to, you know, win the bronze medal. So I go up there and for some reason, I choke so badly. I don't know. There is no explanation to it. Just classic case of choking. Okay. And so I come out of there all out of breath, and which is not like me after one fight, you know. But, you know, come out of there all out of breath. And I spoke to my coach. So he just asked me what happened. I had nothing to tell him because I didn't know myself. It was just no explanation choking. And so then we came back from there, and I showed my coach the clip from the fight. And he asked me a lot of questions, which I had no answers to. And then we started working on it in training. And then what happened is, after that, there were no international tournaments because of the virus situation. And just before the first lockdown started, there was a university national in Patiala. So university nationals, we went there, you know, with no expectations, saying that I am in no shape right now. And, you know, that whatever happens, you just accept it, come back and work on it in training. But I went there and I put in quite a good performance. I came back, showed my coach the clip, and he said that, you know, there is a very stark difference between what you were in Jordan and what you did in Patiala. So the whole thing was just, you know, either it was a mental thing or, you know, I don't know, maybe overwhelmed by the occasion, like I said.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't know, there's no explanation to it. And, you know, the whole key to the whole Patiala performance was coming back, working on it in training, accepting that it happened and not, you know, just trying to dig for answers, just accepting and moving on. Because there are always going to be phases like this, and there's no point in, you know, crying over spilled milk.
So basically, you know what they say, failure is not the opposite of success. It is the way to success.
Right.
Right. Great. Okay. So this gets us to our next question, which is, diet and exercise make up a huge part of your life, right? And so what do you have to say about having a healthy diet and getting ample of exercise?
So exercise, of course, most part of it is taken care of by the coaches and the physical demands of training in general. So while doing a lot of the technical training, meaning I am speaking only for Taekwondo right now, because I don't know about other sports. And exercise, the physical, the technical training for the sport demands a lot of physical, you know, exercise gets taken care of when you train regularly, when you follow a good workout routine at the academy itself. So then, you know, you have to put in basic work on your own in the mornings or whenever. And then whatever technical training, that takes care of the exercise part. But diet, yes, it's a very neglected part of Indian sport. And I think that it can make all the difference in competition. So because, you know, there are many countries, like the top countries in Taekwondo in Asia. If you take Iran, Tajikistan, Korea, their diets are so naturally suitable for sport and physical activity that they outperform people on the basis of physical fitness and muscle strength.
Oh my God.
But because, you know, countries like Iran, Tajikistan, the Middle East, they have a lot of dry fruits by default in their diet because that's what is grown there. And they eat a lot of meat, so high protein. So things like these make a huge difference. And then, so, you know, we are left with the option of supplements. But, you know, supplements are really expensive. And even some of the foods that are natural sources of nutrition are expensive or not available, inaccessible to most of the people. So then that's a big obstacle in the nutrition area. And, you know, I think if that aspect is taken care of, the average performance of sportsmen across the board will rise quite a, you know, large amount.
Mm-hmm.
I recently checked out your Instagram and you do post a lot of workout videos and everything. So, yeah. So what about that? How is that a part of your life?
Actually, the thing is, you know, since this lockdown started, I've been training at home. And since now there are going to be no tournaments in for a long time. So, you know, I thought, why not treat this as an off season and work on, you know, physical conditioning, strength training, and all things not technical. Because once the normal routine at the academy starts, it's going to be mostly technical training, and we are expected to work on our physicals on our own. So, which, you know, it becomes a little difficult with things like college and, you know, helping out at home. So then I thought, why not, you know, use this time to work on strength and conditioning. So what I did was, I used to work out. We have a terrace. I work out there. And one of my friends said, why don't you use this to boost your, you know, boost your reach? Meaning, if you just record it and put it on social media, you get a few people here and there to know your story. Mm-hmm. A few more people will know that there's such a person who's doing something good. And it's just a start. Let's see. We have planned quite a lot of things.
Okay.
But, you know, it's just, we are going slow.
Yeah. Everyone check out his Instagram profile. We will be sharing the link and his username in the description below.
Yeah. Also, like, one more thing that, you know, this lockdown, for a lot of people actually criticized the lockdown and everything. But for us, for basically me, Tanish, and a lot of people, it's been a blessing, because we've grown more than we ever could imagine. And like, it's just about your perspective, right? Like, you're working out at your home while a lot of people are criticizing that they can't go out and are doing nothing. So if you come out of this lockdown with zero skills learned, you actually can't, you don't have the will. You need to build the will to do something. Because this is a very creative period. Yeah, this is a very creative period. This is a period where we need to be creative. If you want to keep constantly growing, if you want to keep progressing, as I mentioned earlier, like, progress equals happiness. You need to keep progressing. You need to keep progressing. And this was a very good period, because everything, like, you were at home, basically. You were, people like us, we never are at home. We always complain that we have to do, we are always out and everything. But this period was really good, because we actually got to be at home and do the things which we actually can't do in under normal circumstances. So yeah, it's all about having the right perspective. So talking about social media, you know, I got to this, like, we have a huge belief in social media. We'll share that soon. So it was that, how do you use social media, and how important is it to actually frame your mindset and reach out to people?
Social media, actually, I have a funny story. I wasn't very big on social media until a little while ago, because I wasn't active on Facebook. I was just, you know, Instagram on and off. That's it. But then, you know, some time ago, during this lockdown, I realized that things like sponsorship, visibility, and even sometimes very important information is accessible only through social media. And that, if used well, social media is a very strong weapon to tell people about the sport, since Taekwondo is like a fringe sport. So most people don't know about it yet. Very few people who practice the sport or know somebody who practices the sport. And that's about it. You know, there is no media coverage of Taekwondo. There is no, you know, hype about Taekwondo. Right. So it's a big challenge. And, you know, social media is one of the tools that can help overcome it in a huge way. Then well-directed use of social media can get you sponsorships, can get you, you know, some of the top corporates can, you know, reach out to you, or you can reach out to them. So that's very important, because once you start playing international tournaments, sponsorship is your backbone. You can't do anything without it. If you, you know, you can have a world rank and an Olympic rank of one, and there is no point if you don't have the right financial backing.
Mm-hmm.
So social media helps us, you know, be spotted and recognized by the top people who are willing to sponsor. And then, you know, athletes need to explore the whole possibilities of social media, because it is, I feel a lot of it is still untapped, because, you know, people are doing really great things with social media. And take you guys, for example. You know, you guys have grown so much in such a short span. And it's mostly, and you started off through social media, right?
Yeah.
So it can make a huge difference. You know, if used well, that is, it's very easy to get carried away on social media too. But well-directed use can be very huge difference. And, you know, I wasn't very fond of using social media. And, you know, I used to be, that's also the reason I have two accounts on Instagram. Mm. So, because I just keep one for my personal use, very limited, you know, circles. And one for the use of getting sponsors or maybe, you know, just the one that is visible to the world.
Amazing.
Yeah.
Great. Okay. Yeah. So this brings us to another question, is that what are your three favorite books?
One is the autobiography of Andre Agassi, which is Open.
Okay.
Then another one, I am not very big on reading. So another one would be Animal Farm.
Okay.
And I guess those two.
Okay. Yeah. You know,
we believe that reading has a huge influence in your mind, and it helps a lot in shaping and grooming the mind. No matter what kind of books do you read, it always is gonna put a positive impact on you. So that is why this is a question that we ask a lot of times.
So yeah. So I want to ask you, how big a role do institutions and organizations we associate ourselves with play in this field?
Yeah. So the role of institutions is quite big. See, I have been very lucky to be a part of all the institutions that I have been a part of so far have been very supportive of my sports. And they have provided me everything I have needed. You know, minor inconveniences here and there, but that's fine. You know, it's part and parcel of being an athlete. And you have to work for everything you get. You know, you can't expect people to give you something for free. So minor inconveniences excluded, they have been very supportive of me. But I know of people who, you know, their school has said that they went to ask for leave for some tournament. And the school says that, no, we won't give you leave for a tournament because you're playing a certain sport and not some other sport. And also that, you know, if you take leave on those days, then we will take strict action against you. So this is the kind of attitude that is also there. So the key is to not, you know, treat one sport as something great and one sport as something that is, you know, unnecessary or,
right,
you know, very wrong. So then the second thing is workplaces. So workplaces can offer athletes very basic things like leave for tournaments. Then, you know, a limited space, you know, limited work during the times they are busy with some of their sporting activities. Then they can give them slight, you know, in case their athlete needs a little bit of financial help, they can give it to them in the form of, you know, anything. It can be kind. It can be money to participate in some local tournament. So very basic things like that. But then again, the point comes in the attitude of the person in charge and how he or she perceives, you know, the sport. So that is very important. And, you know, basically, so let me talk about my institutions. So Symbiosis School, so Shrut, you know, how it was. So the teachers you know, the principal, they were very supportive. They, you know, they would encourage me. They would, you know, give me leave whenever I needed it. They would help me complete, you know, all my assignments and work and stuff. They even rescheduled exams for me. So they supported me a lot. But then, you know, the factor of teachers on one side and the school staff on one side and the students on the other. So, you know, I used to get a lot of negativity from my fellow students, which is absolutely shameful. I mean, if somebody is doing something and you're giving him negativity for it, then it, you know, shows that, you know, the fear of the different, like I said.
Right.
So it needs to be discouraged and it needs to be stopped.
Mm-hmm.
But otherwise, you know, the institutes have been very supportive. And of course, there are going to be characters like this everywhere. So that's fine.
Right. So I also have to ask you about the mental attitudes, like being in a sport where you actually need a lot of strength. What do you have to say about, you know, the mental attitudes in the game?
So you mean like the people around me when...
No, not exactly. About your mental attitude during the game, you know, because it all starts from here. Basically, even I'm a mountaineer and I have been climbing since the age of 12. And I have personally a lot of experience about the mental attitude. Like, everything begins from here. I was on a mountain where the summit was almost impossible. 28 people left the camp and only 5 of them summited. And when asked the rest 23 about why did they give up, everyone told reasons of the mental attitude. It all begins right here. This is what I believe. This is what I have seen. And what do you have to say from the Taekwondo perspective about the mental attitudes?
So, yeah. So, this is a huge factor because it's a combat sport. So, even before enrolling their kid for a Taekwondo class, people have this thing that... you know, what if he gets hurt? So they see it as plain and simple swinging around of the legs and hands, which it is absolutely not. Because people don't know about the sport, so it's natural to have these doubts. But, you know, then once you are a part of it, like I am, you realize that it is about 90% technical and the remaining 10% is physical. And even that physical thing comes from, you know, some people who don't have the same amount of technical skill as the other person. They are the ones who cause injuries and things. So that is what causes fear among the people. And, you know, once you get to a point where I am right now, where you know the sport inside out, you realize that there is nothing to be afraid of. And, it is more performance anxiety than it is the fear of getting hurt. So, you know, there is kicks to the face involved. And people say that, you know, what if there is a serious injury? You know, people get knocked out and stuff like that. I say to them, yes, people do get knocked out. But then that is a part of the sport and it's also kind of the beauty of the sport. So, you know, it's nothing to be afraid of. It's something to be appreciated. And... you know, while playing, the only thing you feel is performance anxiety. And, yeah, you know, that's about it. You just have to go ahead and, you know, you have to embrace it. So I just feel that, you know, this fear that is there is one of the biggest factors. But once you get to a certain level, it just goes away, you know, once you understand the sport better.
Since we are on the topic of the mental attitude and everything, I want to ask you, how important for you is mental health and how do you take care of it?
So yeah, mental health is, I think, again, one of the most neglected things in Indian sport and in most fields, I guess, not only sport.
Right.
Because, you know, people talk about physical strength, people talk about technical skill. Nobody talks about how mental health affects performance and affects the person in general. So, you know, it's really important that athletes are educated about this. Why athletes? Only athletes being educated is not enough. Educate everybody that is involved in the journey of the athlete about mental health.
Right.
And, you know, tell them that it is okay to not be okay and that they have to accept the need to seek help or to talk about mental health. And, you know, they have to go ahead and do it. Not just, you know, say that this is wrong with me, this is wrong with me. Go ahead and get it corrected or right. Get help for it. Because, you know, after an athlete's journey is pretty rough. You know, even is with the kind of routines that athletes usually follow. You know, social life is close to zero. And they really don't have any time for things like, you know, going out with friends and maybe meeting new people and things like that. Because they are so busy and so tired at the end of the day that they don't have the time and the energy for all this. So, you know, that plays a huge role. And, you know, after the Jordan incident that I told you about, I spoke to this sports psychologist who was in the Army Sports Institute. His name is Dr. Vikrant Mahajan. And he helped me through that whole phase. You know, after that, I was like, why am I wasting my time if I am going to perform like this? That was the state I had reached. And, you know, I was like, then I should drop taekwondo and do something that I may actually be good at. You know, that is the level of, you know, how down I was. And I spoke to him. So he just simply, you know, talked me through it. And, you know, he brought me to a stage after it that he gave me a few mantras of super positivity and things like, you know, not looking at the big picture and not looking at one-off results. And he said that, you know, basic things like abstaining from eating some one thing that you like or giving up social media for a while. The basic things that we like a lot and are a huge part of our lives, just staying away from them for some time or simple sacrifices like this can, you know, bring what your major goals are. Like mine is to play the Paris 2024 Olympics. So it's things like these can bring the bigger goals in your life. In fact, the biggest goals in your life into perspective. And it can, you know, help you see clearly the path to these goals.
Right.
So after this Jordan incident, he brought me to a point where I was itching for the next tournament. And, you know, that journey from saying, why should I waste my time, to actually being impatient for the next tournament is a huge journey. Right. So I don't think I can put it in words, but it is a massive change. And in a matter of a few weeks, not even a few months, a few weeks, that is the power of seeking help from someone.
Seeking professional help, right? We talk a lot about this. Your friends might also help you with this complete thing, but you know, seeking professional help always works. We had a great story right here because, you know, Parvand told us about the professional help that he sought with the complete mental health thing, and it actually boosted his career. And you know, this is a suggestion that we give to everyone. Please, if you have any mental health problem, please seek a professional and get everything corrected. Thank you so much for joining us today, Parvand. And
so this, like, I just thought of this, like, it came to me right now. It was like, you know, Steve Jobs said, you know, like, have the courage to follow your heart and intuition. They somehow know what you truly want to become. So this one thing came to my mind, and yeah, I can associate it so much to what you've talked to about today. And yeah, I really loved what you spoke about today, and it's really powerful. So thank you so much, Parvand. We wish you all the best. You know, and guys, thank you so much for tuning in for the You the Future podcast. We hope that you have gained tremendous value and have been served. You know, check us out on Instagram and Facebook as youthefuture.in and You the Future Youth Platform, respectively. We hope to see you next time.
Thanks for having me. It was a pleasure talking to you guys.
Yeah, it was a pleasure.
Yeah, and we are really much looking forward to seeing you play in the 2024 Paris Olympics.
Yeah.
Thank you so much, guys.